God, sing praises to his name, lift up a song to him who rides upon the clouds. His name is the Lord, be exalted before him. Father of orphans and protector of widows is God in his holy habitation. God gives the desolate a home to live in. He leads out the prisoners to prosperity, but the rebellious live in a parched land. O God, when you went out before you, your people, when you marched through the wilderness, the earth quaked, the heavens poured down rain at the presence of God, the God of Sinai, at the presence of God, the God of Israel. Rain in abundance, O God, you showered abroad. You restored your heritage when it languished. Your flock found a dwelling in it. For your goodness, O God, you provided for the needy. Sing to the God, O kingdoms of the earth. Sing praises to the Lord. O rider in the heavens, the ancient heavens, listen. He sends out his voice, his mighty voice. Ascribe power to God, whose majesty is over Israel and whose power is in the skies. Awesome is God in his sanctuary. The God of Israel, he gives power and strength to his people. Blessed be God. Our next reading is from the first letter of Peter, 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 12 to 14, page 235. Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that is taking place among you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice insofar as you are sharing Christ's sufferings, so that you may also be glad and shall rejoice when his glory is revealed. If you are reviled for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory, which is the Spirit of God, is resting on you. Gospel lesson comes from John chapter 17, verses 1 to 11 on page 111. After Jesus had spoken these words, he looked up to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, so that the Son may glorify you. Since you have given him authority over all people to give eternal life to all whom you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth by finishing the work that you gave me to do. So now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had in your presence before the world existed. I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you, for the words that you gave to me I have given to them, and they have received them, and know in truth that I came from you. And they have believed that you sent me. I am asking on their behalf. I am not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one. Thanks be to God.
Would you pray with me? Now may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength, our rock, and our Redeemer. In the name, that wonderful name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. The occasion of the events reported in our gospel passage are monumental. Christ is in the upper room with his disciples. He has concluded serving the first Holy Communion, establishing it as a sacramental commandment for his people. And now he draws aside to pray. He prays. He turns from holding communion with his disciples to holding prayerful communion with his heavenly Father. Yes, Jesus' sacrifice on the cross is there immediately in the future. It is pending. And so he goes and communes with his heavenly Father. This majestic prayer is Jesus' prayer of self-consecration before he turns to the cross. It's commonly referred to as the high priestly prayer, first called such by a Lutheran theologian in the mid-16th century. In this prayer, Jesus consecrates himself for the cross. He shall be for his people both the high priest and the sacrifice on his cross. Note the key phrase in verse 1. Jesus raised his eyes heavenwards. Dramatically, Jesus turns from earth towards the Father in heaven. It is here with his Father that he always draws his strength. Now in the most challenging and in the darkest hour of his life, he once again raises his eyes heavenwards. The time has come. The cross, he knows, is the vehicle of his glory. The cross is not for his glory alone, but by obeying his heavenly Father and by boldly serving even unto death, his heavenly Father is glorified. Why would he be willing to do such a thing for us? Haven't we all asked ourselves that? Haven't we asked that question at some times in our lives? We know ourselves. We know our brokenness. We know our insignificance. We know our sinful limitations compared to and with that name of Jesus, our precious Lord. Why would he be willing to do this, to die for us? Certainly among our first answers of faith, we would include Jesus' incredible pure love for us. Certainly it's hard to fully comprehend that quality of love for us, isn't it? Nevertheless, we know that he loves us. And yet, the scripture in Christ's Father-directed prayer provides a second reason for his willingness to sacrifice himself. You see, Jesus understood as none other has ever understood just what exactly eternal life is. Look carefully at what he says. And this is eternal life, to know thee, the only true God, and the one whom thou hast sent, Jesus Christ. Jesus knows the Father perfectly. He knows himself. He understands his mission. He knows he is the Christ. And Jesus knows, in all this knowing, this perfect knowledge, the nature and quality of eternal life. The nature and quality of eternal life is to know and be known by the Father, to know and be known by the Son, to know and be known by the power of the Holy Spirit. He has glorified the Father. He is glorifying the Father in this prayer. He will glorify the Father on the cross, and the Father will certainly glorify him. Focused in his tremendous and perfect relationship with his heavenly Father, confident in the rectitude of his earthly mission
determined in his desire to obey the Father and fulfill his mission, and anxious to glorify the Father, and sure that the Father will glorify him, Jesus Christ now turns, empowered, to the cross. What a person! What a Lord! What a Savior! And now, having reestablished and reaffirmed all these things in precious prayer, look what comes next. Once again, Christ prays for us. Now he says, "Now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, while I am on my way to thee. Holy Father, keep them in thy name which thou hast given me, that they may be one as we are one." Isn't that just like Jesus? He's praying for us. You see, he knows that it's going to be different now. He won't be there to guard the disciples in the same way that he did so frequently during his earthly ministry. Because he cares so very much for us, he's concerned, and he asks that by the power of God's holy name, we will be protected. Please understand what Jesus is praying for. It's quite important, really. He's praying that the fullness of God's person and the fullness of God's power will protect his disciples. That's what the power of the name is all about. The entire infinite power, the entire majesty of God is being allocated to the protection of his children so that they may have comfort and they may have assurance, even though he's not bodily present anymore. Christ is assigning the totality of the Godhead's power to us. Just try to scratch the surface of what that allocation means to us. Keep them in thy name. The great professor of New Testament, Westcott, in considering this phrase, writes, "The phrase is very remarkable, and it has no exact parallel anywhere else in Scripture. We are given the greatest privilege ever had in history. The very name of God, previously unspoken by any flesh, is appropriated and given to us for unity not only of will and in terms of agreement, but also in terms of nature. By the power of the name of God, Jesus binds all true believers to one another and to himself. For the Christian, there is unity with Christ, forged in the power of God. Count on it in your life. Claim this promise in your life. God's name is given to you. Jesus Christ, in going to the cross, has directed this to you. God's power and person has been given to you." Wow. Can you imagine? This weekend, we are celebrating Memorial Day. And we are remembering brave men and women who have served our country gallantly, making the supreme sacrifice of their lives. How appropriately we as Christians begin by remembering the ultimate sacrifice of Jesus Christ. The Son of God's sacrifice is the greatest of all history. And how appropriate it is that we gratefully remember our country who have served and sacrificed for us. They believed in liberty and justice. They cherished freedom and democracy. They loved their country.
They gave of themselves for our nation's high ideals, ideals which we must still pursue. Democracy, liberty, justice, equality. What enabled their sacrifices at Valley Forge, Gettysburg, the Black Forest, the Battle of the Bulge, Iwo Jima, and China, the Tet Offensive, Afghanistan, and Iraq? What enabled their sacrifice on land and sea and air? In their court was their belief, their faith grounded in the belief that God would bless their nation because of the rightness of our ideals. They will not be forgotten, and we must not forget that for which they died. Not as long as those beliefs and ideals they fought for and died sometimes are neglected by us. We must pursue the same to truly honor their memory. Pursuing the ideals of liberty and justice is not an easy task, is it? It's never been easy. Throughout history, it has always been costly. Pursuing the kingdom of God, and to make that our reality for our Christian faith, cost Jesus his life. But as we as Christian citizens continue to pursue liberty, democracy, justice, and equality, I want you to remember that we in Christ do so. We in Christ do so by the power of thy name, by the power of God's name, and by the power of God's name, it can be done, it must be done. For Christ prayed for this for us, and God's name is available to us. Recently, I visited a parishioner, and we had a conversation about favorite sermons. One of her favorite sermons was, "How can you just sit there?" When you understand Christ's high priestly prayer for us, and his allocation of the power of God's name for us, I agree with that parishioner. You cannot just sit there. Keep them in thy name, Jesus prayed. Remember this promise and prayer of Christ, especially on Memorial Weekend. Remember this promise of Jesus Christ.